Support for Silver King, the birth of big game fishing, comes from the following. Sunshine Ace Hardware, a Southwest Florida resource for name brand fishing gear. Location information at sunshineace.com. The beaches of Fort Myers and Sanibel. Experience the wonder of Southwest Florida's natural islands and beaches. Information at fortmyerssanibel.com. City of Fort Myers, Imaginarium Science Center, and Southwest Florida Museum of History. And by Doc Ford's Rum Bar and Grill on Sanibel Island and Fort Myers Beach. Tropical flavors with Caribbean flair.
In 1885, few had ever heard of a sleepy Florida frontier town called Fort Myers. But that was about to change.
For the first time on record, a massive fish, a tarpon, had been caught on a rod and reel, a feat that stirred a frenzy of excitement and made Southwest Florida the epicenter of a brand new sport.
The newly crowned Silver King of Fish lured anglers from around the world and established Southwest Florida as the birthplace of big game fishing.
The angler thrills to the tarpon's jump. Not only because they are spectacularly beautiful, but because they present such a keen challenge to his angling skill. Whether he's greyhounding like this, or jackknifing as this 130-pounder is doing here, the poetry of his motion compels you to hail him as the Silver King.
For more than a century, fierce fighting tarpon have captivated anglers with their steely strength and acrobatic air shows. The shimmering silver-sided giants have reigned as sport fishing royalty since 1885, when William Halsey Wood caught and documented the first large tarpon ever taken on a rod and reel in Tarpon Bay, Sanibel Island, Florida. His astounding catch launched a new sport and a passion for tarpon, the mythical, magical, still mysterious Silver King of game fish.
You can watch anglers literally speaking tongues when they see a bait or a lure or a fly disappear with a tarpon bite. And once they're hooked, they put on an aerial display that would pretty much rival any fish out there. And then it's this cat and mouse game where you keep it just right above their nose. And at the last moment, they just explode on it. I can get goosebumps just talking about it right now. They're just an amazingly cool creature. They're beautiful chrome silver, and they just have the ability to stop an angler's heart.
When you're pursuing the tarpon, you see them, and they may be daisy chaining, they may be cruising, they may be laying up on top of the water. And then your knees start shaking. What happens to me is I forget to breathe because I'm holding my breath when I'm making a cast to a tarpon. I want it to land in the perfect spot so badly because I know if it does and that tarpon comes up and eats, the fight is on.
It'll be coming up. Yeah, look at that. Woohoo!
Some days you see these fish coming 100, 150 yards away, heading right at you. And they look like big, dark torpedoes coming at you. And the heart rate starts picking up. They come flying out of the water. And so much of the time you can hear their gills rattling and see those bright red gills that they show. And you never know what kind of a jump that you're going to see. You're just awestruck.
I chase the tarpon a lot. They are a wild adversary, and they're smart, and they've learned their habits and protective instincts over millions and millions of years through trial and error and preservation. So to pursue them, we have to think like a fish and think like the particular species that we're going after. And I guess that's part of the challenge and part of the game that really makes it interesting.
Tarpon, the silver-sided sirens of southwest Florida, were once considered an angling pipe dream. Mere rods and reels were no match for the massive, mighty fighters until March 19, 1885, when William Halsey Wood turned the dream of reeling in a tarpon into reality. Using a bamboo rod and mullet for bait, Wood caught a 93-pound tarpon in Sanibel Island's aptly named Tarpon Bay and revolutionized sport fishing.
His feat was a dramatic beginning to big game fishing. His catch was actually the first big game fish caught on rod and reel, and it was documented worldwide, in fact. There are other claims to that piece of fame, all for tarpon, but Wood basically put the record on ice and took it to New York to show everybody what he'd caught.
Wood's exciting descriptions of the fierce fighting fish and his capture of not just one, but five silver kings galvanized public attention and made headlines across the globe.
I cast the bait out near his head, and he whirled, making toward it. After getting the bait, he moved slowly away. The instant the slack was taken up, I drew and hooked him. He came instantaneously, entirely out of the water, trying to shake out the bait. Then the trouble began. We paddled after him, and he, racing and leaping until he had made six leaps and had run half a mile. I found I was tiring him out, as he could not then leap entirely out of the water. After getting him pretty well tired out, I suggested gaffing him, while my man thought he might knock the skiff to pieces. I reeled the fish toward me, and when he got within reach, Mr. Smith gaffed him through the gills in a splendid manner. The feat was accomplished. A tarpon had been caught with a 21-thread line on a 5-foot bamboo rod and a large reel. The time was 26 and a half minutes from the moment the fish made his first leap to the time we placed him in the skiff. William Halsey Wood.
The glittering new game fish of Florida began luring anglers from around the world, all eager to take up the gauntlet against the feisty fish.
It really set a fire, and you know, people really started to want to go after tarpon. I mean, Florida was put on the map as a destination, much like Africa is for big game hunting. It was still kind of a bit of an unknown place, and going after these big fish was very exotic. So the rush for silver, so to speak, was on.
Traveling to the distant kingdom of the newly crowned silver king of game fish, however, required time and money. With neither railroads nor roads reaching into the vast wilderness of the southwest Florida frontier, the hallowed grounds of the Holy Grail of fish could only be reached by boat. The New York Times advised eager anglers, city sportsmen can take a sleeping car from Jersey City direct to Port Tampa, and then can step aboard a boat that will carry him down the coast. As the tarpon craze escalated, rail service was extended to the tiny town of Punta Gorda, closer to the heart of tarpon territory, but still a grueling 50-hour trip from New York. Anglers then boarded steamboats to the tarpon fishing towns of St. James City, Punta Rossa, Fort Myers, and Naples. Once at their destination, sportsmen found a raw, rough frontier and little else. At the wharf at Punta Rossa, anglers could rent rooms from George Schultz, manager of the telegraph station. The ramshackle building, a former army barracks built during the Seminole Wars, was where Wood stayed during his now famous angling adventure in southwest Florida. A sign on the door warned, "This is the end of the world. Jump right off."
But the rickety retreat's proximity to the prime fishing grounds made Schultz's makeshift hotel a popular place to stay for serious tarpon hunters, and anglers vied for the rustic rooms in the narrow hallway jokingly dubbed Murderer's Row. At the same time Wood captured his first silver king and the attention of the world, the rough hostelry hosted another well-known guest, Thomas Edison, the renowned wizard of electricity. Edison traveled up the Caloosahatchee River and was so impressed with the small town of Fort Myers that he bought 13 acres on the river, where he built his winter home. Wood's record-making catch inspired Edison to become an avid tarpon hunter. He later told reporters, "The finest tarpon fishing in the world is right in front of my house in Florida. So many tarpon and other fish come up the shallow river that it raises it 11 inches every season." Schultz's no-frills lodge soon faced competition from the San Carlos Hotel. Built just a year after Wood's famous fish focused the attention of sportsmen from around the world firmly on Southwest Florida. Tarpon hunters, weary of bunking in the former military barracks, could now enjoy first-class accommodations in the 50-room hotel situated on the southern tip of Pine Island. A guest of the new hotel reported, "Ladies can now accompany their husbands without risk of being otherwise than very comfortable or even of being bored, unless it is by the everlasting discussion as to the habits of the Silver King and the proper mode of capturing him, which goes on incessantly."
It was quite a bit nicer than Schultz's converted barracks, although Schultz had a little edge in that he had a telegraph there, so the men could buy and sell stocks before and after they went fishing.
Further south, the new town of Naples also attracted tarpon hunters.
"The principal industry of the place is fishing for tarpon, all the fishermen being northern people who fish not for profit, but for glory. The most influential man in town is the man who catches the biggest tarpon. To arrive there without a bundle of fishing rods and tackle is to incur the suspicion that attaches to a stranger who goes to a hotel without baggage. Are they biting is the watchword of the town." WD, New York Times.
Anglers willing to spend the time and money to find nearly untouched fishing grounds were advised to head even further south to the tarpon-filled 10,000 islands.
"As difficult as it is to get to Marco, it's harder still to leave there. From Marco to Everglades, 25 miles. This is the last place on the West Coast where a fisherman can be comfortably housed. If the storters like your looks, you'll find yourself in pleasant quarters. In 3 days, I took 32 tarpon here. Further south, the fisherman must have a cruising boat or be prepared to camp out." A.W. Dimmock, Outing Magazine.
First-class accommodations were also soon available in Fort Myers. The new Royal Palm Hotel offered a clubhouse complete with a bowling alley, billiards room, and a pool. Other innovations included a dark room for amateur photographers and an angler's room for tackle outfitting and repair. Boats and guides were also available. Anglers looking for easy access to the fishing grounds could book rooms in the San Carlos Hotel's unusual Adjunct Lodge, a floating hotel boasting 21 staterooms, 2 toilets, a wine room, and dining salon, anchored just south of Boca Grande Pass. Despite its prime location, some anglers found even closer accommodations, to the chagrin of the floating hotel manager, who wrote a letter of complaint.
"U.S. Lighthouse Inspector, I take the liberty of writing to you to find out if the lighthouse keeper at Boca Grande, Florida, has a right to make a boarding house out of the lighthouse. I have a hotel here, paying taxes. It's across from the pass and a little further away from the fishing than the lighthouse is, and therefore he takes my boarders away from me. E. H. Hughes."
Competition was stiff for the well-heeled tarpon hunters. One annoyed tarpon hunter warned, "It was not long before we discovered that a tarpon fisherman in Florida is looked upon as a sort of walking gold mine,
from whose pockets as much of the precious metal as possible should be extracted on all occasions. The tab for tarpon fishing added up quickly. One sporting goods dealer estimated that it cost anglers about $500 for each tarpon he killed in Florida. By 1902, the wealthy and well-connected had another option for accommodations, the Yuseppa Inn, built by streetcar tycoon John Roach, to cater to an elite group of devoted anglers.
I would imagine, for the same reason that everybody else that has family come visit during the wintertime, he had tons of relatives and friends that came down. He was a very well-known businessman in Chicago, and he ended up building a 20-room inn on the north end of the island. The location of Yuseppa is absolutely fantastic for tarpon fishing, which is why everybody was coming here at that time period. We're equally distanced between Captiva Pass and Boca Grande Pass. It was $3.50 to $5. It provided two glorious meals at the inn and a box lunch. It would be a little extra charge to have a guide and to be towed out to the passes. In those days, and that was pretty expensive, the average person obviously did not come to Yuseppa.
Guests enjoyed the additional luxury of a tow out to the best fishing grounds.
They had a steamer called the Valima that towed the guides in a string of rowboats. And when they reached the pass, where the anglers would then disembark and get into the rowboat with the guide who would maneuver the boat throughout the day, sometimes after hooking a fish, rowed the angler to shore to fight the fish from shore. But all that was done out of the Valima, which was the mothership that ferried these anglers and guides back and forth.
Most guides were commercial fishermen who knew the local waters and knew how to find tarpon.
One of the largest groups were the African Americans that were here in Southwest Florida. This area, post-Civil War, this was an opportunity on the frontier that gave African Americans in particular an opportunity to gain wealth and to make a living here in the South.
For subsistence fishermen on the Florida frontier, tarpon hunters offered easy money.
Very few people had any need or want to hook or land a tarpon. They were not good to eat, and so they were more trouble than they were worth in most cases until the sports fishermen decided that they wanted to catch them for sport. It would really increase the commerce in the area greatly. At one point, my grandmother had a boarding house and catered to tarpon fishermen. They did well in those days. The guy, the only thing he had to do was have a boat and be able to catch the bait and then get to where the fish were. So it was a hell of a lot easier than spending hours and hours a day, nighttime, whatever it was, commercial fishing. All in all, commercial fisherman life was pretty rough, and you had to be either real dumb or real tough or both to stay with it.
Working as a tarpon guide, however, wasn't easy.
They were using rowboats and canoes where the guide actually had to paddle around. He had to chase the fish. He had to drag it inshore if they were taking measurements. Basically, it was a really hard job for the guides. It was a very dangerous job. Tarpon have jumped into boats and smashed guides to death. I know one African-American in the past was killed by a tarpon that knocked him overboard and he drowned.
Dealing with the fierce fighting fish demanded skill and strength, and few tarpon hunters fished without a guide. But finding the right guide was critical. A guide could make or break a fishing trip. Outing magazine cautioned its readers, a guide must be selected with even more care than the reel, rod, or line. If he can row fast enough to ease the strain on the line, the tarpon will tire of his straight tug and recommence his jumps and rushes. If not, the reel will soon be empty and the angler's cup of bitterness full. The fast and furious rush of a hooked tarpon could rip all the line off a reel in seconds and rip the skin off an angler's hand.
early tackle in the 1800s bears little to no resemblance to what we have today. The rods were made out of cane or wood and were either brittle or extremely stout, probably the extremes of the two. And the reels were exceedingly simple. There was no clutch or break in it, so they were often termed knuckle crackers because when the line went out, the handle spun in the opposite direction. So there was a great deal of skill and finesse involved in trying to subdue a very large fish with that type of primitive tackle.
After bruising and burning his hands landing a 210-pound tarpon, New York reel maker Edward von Hoff invented the Star Drag Reel, patented in 1902 and still in use today for big game fishing.
Even with our fancy equipment today, these fish will take off and you won't turn them around. The Star Drag system revolutionized fishing, certainly tarpon fishing.
The new reel allowed line to release while the handle remained steady, an innovative and expensive improvement.
I hate to advise it, but if you can spare the $20 or $30 or $40 for a powerful reel of fine workmanship containing the automatic handle brake would stop, you'll find it your soul's welfare. A.W. Dimmock, Outing Magazine.
For what they had back in those days, they were like the fine jewels of the jewelry world. When you get a chance to feel one of them, you'll feel there's power in those reels. And there's a feel about them that is, once you feel one, if you're a fisherman, you'll never forget them. The reels that von Hoff made were very much like today's reels are, with the exception of some design changes in materials. There was a fellow that used to come down here and fish with him off and on named Van Vleck. And Van Vleck came from Toledo, and he had a forging business in Toledo, Ohio. And as the story goes, von Hoff asked him that when he went back home if he would make him a hook that was stout enough to handle these fish down here, the tarpon. And Van Vleck did, and it's kind of amazing to see how the style of the Van Vleck hook now is in comparison to what hooks are nowadays. The only major difference is the Van Vleck hook had the barbs on the outside of the point, and they were double. And the hooks nowadays, the barb is to the inside of the hook. But shape and design, they're very, very close to what a lot of the guys were using really up until now.
Even with the best equipment and an expert guide, capturing a tarpon required a combination of skill, luck, and patience.
The hardened cynic might describe tarpon fishing as sitting all day in a Turkish bath watching a string. The tarpon is a grand and lordly fish, but is sly, devilishly sly, and dainty as a miss in love. Alvin S. Southworth, Leslie's Popular Monthly.
The fascinating, frustrating fish seem to have an uncanny awareness of the danger of dangling hooks, with a finicky preference for bait that one angler claimed changes as often as a chameleon changes color. With a tough, bony, nearly impenetrable mouth, hooking the well-armored Silver King was virtually impossible unless the fish swallowed the hook or was snagged in the tiny, vulnerable corner of its jaws. If an angler was lucky enough to hook a tarpon, the wily fish was well known for leaping high into the air and throwing the hook out of its mouth. Experienced tarpon hunters estimated that only one fish in four would be hooked, and of those, only one in four would ever be landed. The tricky, tough-to-catch Silver King helped train a new breed of angler and made offshore big-game fishing a reality.
Tarpon being so available for anglers allowed them to really fine-tune fish-fighting skills on the primitive tackle on the day. And so much to the point that when the first bluefin tuna was caught in 1896 by a gentleman of the last name of Morehouse, he was actually a veteran tarpon angler. And he acknowledged that using his skills that he had learned from fighting big tarpon inshore in Florida helped him greatly in catching the first tuna on rod and reel.
The tarpon fishing fraternity quickly became co-ed. Women were assured by guidebook writers that catching one of the massive, mesmerizing fish required more brains than brawn. With finesse and good fortune, technique could triumph over the Silver King. Well-known outdoor writer A.W. Demick, who caught 354 tarpon in 52 days during a fishing trip along the Southwest Florida coast, advised,
"The tarpon can be played gently and easily, with a light strain from a smooth running reel, with an effort that wouldn't tire a robust child for 1, 2, or 3 hours, until he rolls over on his back, exhausted and ready for the hook to be removed from his mouth. Or he can be fought furiously from the start, the boat dragged near him, and little line yielded, while the fish leaps wildly and frequently round, beside, over, and even into the boat of the fisherman. Now, this method calls for strength of muscle, tackle, and nerves, but there's little in the line of sport that returns bigger dividends and excitement." A.W. Demick, The Book of the Tarpon.
Women quickly mastered the new sport. Just 6 years after Wood caught the first tarpon on a rod and reel, a woman held the record for the largest Silver King, a mammoth 205-pound tarpon.
Some of the best anglers were the Hunt family women who caught as many as 21 tarpon in 2 weeks. Nan Hunt in 1912 caught a dozen in 1 week. And these were on equipment that was fairly primitive by today's standards.
The biggest and best specimens were sent to the taxidermist. Anglers were reassured by guidebook writers, "Close by is a taxidermist who will stuff tarpon at a price of $5 per foot, so the sportsman need never bid adieu to his finest fish." Tarpon scales also became coveted trophies, with successful anglers proudly writing their name, date, and the weight of the fish on the tough, translucent scales. According to the Fort Myers Press, the scale from the first Silver King is to the tarpon fisher what the knight's spurs were to the soldier. Hotel lobbies and walls were covered with the giant scales, hard-won proof of a tarpon hunter's conquest of the Silver King. The exotic silver tip scales were nearly worth their weight in gold. The New York Times reported, "The heavy, metallic-looking scales sell in Florida for as high a price as 25 cents.
At one time, when I was a young man, there was a market for tarpon scales. And so I would catch some tarpon and kill them, take the scales off, and sell the scales by the pound, which was pretty lucrative. They made some kind of jewelry and things out of them. And that was all right, except the work of taking the scales off got to be damn tough. You know, the scales are really on there tough, and to take the scales off a whole tarpon turned out to be more work than it was worth."
Once the scales were removed, there was little market for the rest of the fish. A Washington Post writer warned readers, "As a table fish, the tarpon is not a great success. Though with such sauces as a French chef knows how to prepare, it is not altogether to be despised when nothing better can be had." Most fish were weighed, measured, displayed for trophy photographs, and thrown away.
Many fishermen around here would go out and they would catch their catch and they'd string them up on a line. They would take photos. They'd use them as fertilizer, use them as chicken feed. Not many people actually ate the fish. It was all about just the glory and the pictures to share with friends.
Despite a seemingly endless supply of fish, by the early 1900s, sportsmen were becoming concerned about the senseless slaughter of so many Silver Kings.
"Don't murder your game. To wantonly sacrifice these beautiful and harmless creatures after they have added so greatly to your pleasure is causeless cruelty. They can be measured without harming them. The cube of their length in feet divided by 2 gives their weight in pounds as nearly as needful." A.W. Demick, The Book of the Tarpon.
Anglers at the Yusepa Inn took note and began promoting something new: catch and release.
In 1903, a small group of people decided to create their own membership, their own little club, where they would follow proper fishing etiquette, more conservation-minded techniques.
Within a few years, the devoted anglers of the inn had formed the Isaac Walton Club, named after the revered 17th century English author of The Complete Angler.
It was a prestigious fishing club. They would keep track of all the tarpon that they caught. They listed it in registers, where they caught them, what it weighed, the date that they caught it. They had buttons that they gave out for the different catches. They gave out a silver button for the first tarpon that was caught, a gold button for the tarpon that weighed 150 pounds, and a gold and diamond button for a tarpon that weighed over 150 pounds. C.B. Hawley was the first woman to receive a diamond button, and she was credited with creating the circle hook, which is still used today.
As the rich and famous tallied their tarpon takes on the Isaac Walton Club celebrated ledger, the New York Times noted, society is giving up its golf clubs for the tarpon rod. While the Silver King reigned supreme, anglers quickly discovered other game in the fish-rich waters of Southwest Florida. Even if the tarpon weren't biting, most likely an angler would catch something. Outing magazine noted, you may be constantly troubled by catching fine, large food fishes. One day, one of our party found himself hooked to a loggerhead turtle. Often, however, the hook is seized by some predatory shark. Sharks, especially in Boca Grande Pass, proved a persistent problem, with the pesky predators infamous for stealing hooked tarpon and an angler's chance at catching a silver king. Yet the challenge of catching a large fish, even a shark, proved irresistible. The big and bizarre were fair game in Southwest Florida.
A lady angler named Greta Hostetter had an ultra-low-key summation of an event in Boca Grande Pass. She wrote in the tarpon log, "Hooked tarpon weight about 100 pounds. After two jumps, devoured by shark. Landed shark with assistance of guide Santina. Tarpon inside, estimated weight 750 pounds.
The lure of big fish attracted many anglers, including pioneer railroad builder Henry B. Plant, who caught his first silver king in the Caloosahatchee River. He later built the 250-room Hotel Punta Gorda to cater to big game anglers. Big fish and big game kept wealthy adventurers coming back for more, inspiring Harvey Heitman and Captain E.L. Evans to open the Heitman-Evans Company in 1909. The Fort Myers Sporting Goods Store eventually became one of the largest outfitting stores south of Abercrombie and Fitch in New York City. Evans, affectionately dubbed the Dean of Tarpon Fishing, specialized in supplying guides, charter yachts, and custom-made fishing equipment to anglers.
The industry for the tackle was in its infancy at this time. Things were being invented on a regular basis. What really separated the Evans-Heitman store was is they were at the forefront of this. And not only, they weren't just supplying tackle, they were creating tackle. And they were creating new lures and new rods and new reels at the request of the fishermen that were coming down. And so the Evans store really became not only the supplier, but also kind of the testing grounds, the research and development for big game fishing.
Evans developed a wide range of lures and hooks, including the popular Evans Self-Striker Spoon, specially designed for the nearly impenetrable mouth of the Silver King. Although anglers could now outfit in Fort Myers, most preferred to fish near the passes, especially Boca Grande Pass, where the famed fish teemed in the deep water channel. By 1912, a new train into Boca Grande and a new luxury hotel nearby offered anglers easy access to the legendary pass. Not to be outdone, the new owner of Yuseppa Island, streetcar advertising tycoon Baron Collier, added a 9-hole golf course and expanded the hotel, which he renamed the Tarpon Inn.
Baron Collier made a good bit of his fortune by establishing a string of tarpon fishing hotels. He owned the Gasparilla Inn on Boca Grande, and also the Rod and Gun Club in Everglades City, where they had the longest of the tarpon seasons. Actually, you can catch tarpon year-round out of Everglades City.
Tarpon hunters could also enjoy a new luxury, faster access to the pass on board gas-powered guideboats.
Once the gas-powered engines started being used in the smaller boats, it allowed them more time on the water. None of the boats were over 20 feet, but they had engines, and then they did the same thing, only they left here on the boat that they were going to fish and still fished primarily the tides. But if they needed to, they could fish against the tide. And of course, that was a major, major change.
As tarpon fishing moved away from Fort Myers, Thomas Edison told reporters that he knew the reason why. Tarpon had left the Caloosahatchee River because mullet and other small fish, food for tarpon, were being overfished by commercial net fishermen. He warned city officials, "The tourists are going where the fish are, and if you want to stay on the map, protect the fish." Although Edison laid the groundwork for a controversy that would continue for decades, in truth, the life cycle and migration patterns of tarpon remained a mystery. The Isaac Walton Club tried to solve the mystery, but failed.
In 1910, through the teens, they were actually tagging fish in those days. And they stopped when they recognized that the tagging, because they didn't have the technology that we have, the tagging was detrimental to the fish. So they stopped the tagging.
The mysterious, mesmerizing sovereign of sport fishing continued to reign as the undisputed king of game fish and continued to lure a long list of celebrities to South Florida and the Keys. Former President Teddy Roosevelt stayed in a houseboat anchored off Captiva Island, catching tarpon and harpooning giant rays. Best-selling writer Ernest Hemingway also became an avid tarpon and big game angler and wrote about the Silver Kings, their strange and wild things of unbelievable speed and power. And the beauty in the water and leaping is indescribable, and something you would never see if you did not fish for them.
Once Collier started promoting and advertising, you know, people from all over the world arrived. And that's the time period that a lot of celebrities and a lot of political people visited Yosepa.
Guests included President Herbert Hoover, mystery writer Mary Roberts Reinhart, actress Mae West, and best-selling Western writer Zane Grey.
I think it was a place to be and a place to be seen at that time because of all the celebrities, and I think people that had the means to go anywhere and do anything, I think they felt that Yosepa was a very special place because of the people that came here.
Zane Grey, an avid angler, wrote about his fishing adventures, thrilling readers with his descriptions of the Silver King.
"He began a series of magnificent tactics. He stood on his tail, then on his head. He sailed like a bird. He closed his huge gills with a slap. And most remarkable of all, he rose in the shape of a crescent to straighten out with such marvelous power that he seemed to actually crack like a whip." Zane Grey, Tales of Fishes, 1919.
Several years later, Grey's fascination with big game fishing inspired him to try to catch a world record tuna in Nova Scotia. Grey needed a boat and commissioned Williams Boatways in Fort Myers to build the 25-foot craft, modeling the boat after the skiffs used by Florida mullet fishermen.
Our craftsmen were able to show off their skills to people that otherwise would have never thought of it. The idea that you could build a boat here in Southwest Florida, then go catch a world record tuna in Nova Scotia, shows the skill that they did have.
On August 22nd, 1924, Gray, with his Fort Myers captain and boatman Bob King at his side, caught a world-record tuna weighing 758 pounds. He credited his new launch, equipment purchased from the Heitman Evans Company, and King for making it all possible. Although Prohibition was in full swing, guests of the Tarpon fishing hotels never lacked for luxuries, including liquor. Many fishing guides supplemented their income in the lucrative but illegal business of bootlegging.
My dad was a bootlegger, had boats that ran to the Bahamas to pick up English liquor, and had a fair amount of clients that bought the liquor at Boca Grande. And so when the boats came in here, they unloaded, and then he would take some liquor up there and sold it. They had to have that good English liquor and wines and cordials and things, and so made a pretty good buck doing that. But then, of course, you got to dodge the revenuers all the time. He never got caught, but he got scared a few times.
Woodring's mother, Esperanza, also worked as one of the first female fishing guides.
She learned to commercial fish from my dad, and later on she learned to guide. It was really a great life in lots of ways. The hotels where these guys were staying, this was winter season always, would build a picnic basket with sandwiches and everything. And if they knew they were going to have a possibility of fried fish, well, they'd put some extra bacon in there. Mom had a frying pan. And up at the mangroves there, there's one little spot that's a little high ground. It was easy to get into right from the boat. And she had a couple of bricks there and lots of firewood, so it was easy to build a fire. This was known as Duffy's Tavern because it was also a good spot for the guys to relieve themselves after being in the boat for a few hours.
Although anglers had learned a few secrets about catching the elusive Silver King, the life cycle of the glittering game fish remained a mystery. In 1939, Tarpon hunters, eager to learn more about their royal adversary, established a research laboratory on Cabbage Key, a small island 4 miles south of Boca Grande Pass. Researchers tagged juvenile tarpon, hoping to learn more of the movement, migration, and growth of the fish. But again, the secret life of the Silver King remained a secret.
What they used for tagging the fish wasn't as advanced as what we use now, so the tags weren't as effective. They didn't stay in the fish as long. The techniques that they used perhaps to age the fish and do other types of things weren't as advanced as ours, so they were working at a great disadvantage. And again, they were working with absolutely zero known about tarpon. But even now, we've learned a lot, but there's still a lot that we don't know.
What scientists do know is that tarpon are an ancient species retaining a prehistoric primitive lung that enables the fish to gulp oxygen from the air, an evolutionary advantage that allows juvenile tarpon to live in nearly stagnant backwater creeks, safely away from predators. Where the Silver King spawn also remains an unsolved mystery.
The lack of real knowledge on tarpon is part of the fascination even now. The goal of the research isn't to figure out absolutely everything about the fish. It's to figure out enough so that we can be sure that they're properly managed and the habitats they depend on are properly managed. We're very careful to not conduct research that is aimed at improving fishermen's ability to catch them. That's the fishermen's problem.
The challenge of catching the fascinating king of game fish continued to entice a rising tide of tarpon hunters, but the royal sport was no longer reserved for the rich and famous. The shallow water Silver King offered an equal opportunity to anglers on a boat or on land, and could be taken with live bait or a lure, trolling, casting, or bottom fishing.
Tarpon are accessible. That's one of their best qualities. If you ask people what species they consider to be a big game fish, you'll undoubtedly hear tarpon, but you'll also hear marlin, swordfish, sailfish, and big tunas. Tarpon's different because it's an inshore fish. Often we're pursuing these fish in relatively shallow water, 6 feet or less, and in very clear water, or water that's certainly clear enough to see the fish. So Instead of traditional fishing where you hook a fish and see a fish, you see the fish first. And this gives you the ability to present a fly or a lure or a bait to it and say, okay, I want to catch that fish right there.
The vast kingdom of the Silver King stretched all along the south coast of Florida. But Boca Grande Pass remained Mecca to most tarpon hunters. Although catch and release was more common, tarpon were still taken for taxidermy and trophies.
To eliminate any useless slaughter of these gallant tarpon, it is customary to release all but exceptional catches, which of course must be hauled ashore and weighed for the Button Award.
Tarpon tournaments and rodeos offered anglers competition and cash for the capture of the big silver kings.
Records show that fishermen from this island alone have caught over 17,000 of these silver warriors. Many thousands of these, of course, were released. It must be remembered that only the prize fish are brought to shore. And two, for every tarpon brought to boat, at least five others threw the hook on their first or second jump and escaped.
Although the fierce fighting silver kings often threw the hook, decades of selective slaughter was beginning to take a toll, and concerned anglers called on the state to help protect the king of game fish.
The thing that's really been the biggest lifesaver, if you will, for tarpon is the tarpon tag law that was passed in 1988 with help from the Boca Grande fishing guides, from the entire tarpon fishing community. Now an angler has to pay $50 in advance to a county tax collector for a tarpon tag, which has to be placed on the tarpon. Tarpon deaths went from thousands to practically none. Since then, there have just been a relative handful of tags used every year, and that's been mostly in the course of tournaments. Very few tarpon are killed for mounts anymore, and that's really been the saving grace for tarpon in Florida. They've rebounded to the point where 200-pound fish are relatively common now, when in the years before the tag was instituted, a 150-pound fish was the talk of the town.
The new kill tag ended the unnecessary slaughter of the Silver Kings and the need for taxidermists to preserve an angler's trophy. Lifelike fiberglass models took the place of actual skin mounts.
Ike Shaw Taxidermy was established in Fort Myers in 1899 and was a thriving business until 1988, but it wasn't too long after the tarpon tag law went into effect that the current owner, Bob Davis, was forced to sell out, and the business closed forever.
More than a century after the first tarpon was taken on a rod and reel, anglers no longer needed to kill the silver-sided king of game fish to prove their prowess. With catch and release and care, the long reign of the Silver King could continue.
They recover relatively quickly, and if they're treated well by anglers, their survival is well over 90%. Last year, we conducted a study on the economic value of tarpon in Charlotte Harbor, and just residents, not tourists, had an economic impact of $120 million. And that is as a catch-and-release fishery. If they're harvested, then you have a one-time benefit to them. People travel from around the world to Florida to fish for tarpon, which tells you a lot. They're spending many thousands of dollars just so they can go out and catch a fish and then let it go. So it's got to be something pretty special. People spend a lot of money and time chasing tarpon, lose sleep, all that type of stuff.
I think people should have such reverence for this fish. I mean, it's a fish that lives to be so old, you know? I mean, it's a renewable resource. You get the ability to utilize this fish again and again and again and again. So why not treat it the best you can so they're around?
K keeping tarpon around as the goal of current research programs as scientists continue to search for clues to the secretive silver king.
People often ask, well, why do you care where they go? The Gulf oil spill is a great example of not having information and how that can impact an entire system, not to mention a fish population. We're pretty sure that they spawn offshore 100 miles or so, say off the coast of Boca Grande. And that would put them right out in an area where there's some thought about doing some oil drilling. Or there could be offshore dumping. We want to know where they spawn so we can put a little red box around that spot and say, none of that activity here.
Despite increased protection for the Silver King, scientists and anglers can't agree on the status of the tarpon population. Are tarpon declining, rebounding, or relocating?
You talk to some of the old-time guides in Boca Grande Pass, they'll tell you that the old records of the most tarpon caught by a single boat in a single day in the pass will never be broken because there aren't enough fish for that to happen anymore. And they were told that by the guys that preceded them. So it's possible that there are fewer tarpon. It's also possible that the tarpon have changed their behavior and are going other places. Way back then, most of the fish were kept, not for food, but just as trophies. And so when you consider how long tarpon live, we could still be seeing some of the repercussions from that type of fishing behavior.
When this one was taken in to be weighed, he hit the scale at 128 and a half pounds. Not bad for a 12-pound test rig.
Here is the once gallant warrior, every inch a fighter from the tip of his great undershot jaw down to the fork of his mighty tail. Proudly we salute you, Silver King of the Gulf.
The famed fish can live to be more than 80 years old with a mysterious memory-like awareness of the dangers of dangling hooks.
They got so smart that I kind of gave up on that because I wasn't good enough to fake them out anymore with a fly. I wouldn't want to call a tarpon smart, but they've gotten the idea that small skiffs with electric trolling motors are dangerous to be around, and they kind of get lockjaw when they know what's up.
It's quite possible that they learn to a certain extent about things to eat and not to eat. Although you go out there one day and you throw everything you have at them and they won't eat it, and even live bait, and then you go out the next day, you could throw a tennis ball in the water and they'd eat it. So they're fish. If it was too easy, people wouldn't do it.
The Silver King of game fish still fascinates and frustrates anglers. The pessimistic predictions of more than a century ago still hold true. Only one fish in four might be hooked, and of those, few will ever be landed. The mighty, mythical fish has defied many anglers, including one of its most devoted fans, Thomas Edison. Although the inventor caught small tarpon, he never landed a giant Silver King. He pursued the glittering game fish until his death in 1931 and told reporters as he was leaving Fort Myers for the last time, "I sure did hate to quit just when they were biting good, but I'll be back earlier next year and stay longer. You undoubtedly have the best fishing grounds in the world." Challenges of the magical, mysterious, addictive fish continues to lure anglers to Southwest Florida. Tarpon Bay, where William Halsey Wood caught the first big tarpon on a rod and reel and launched a brand new sport
is now part of the J.N. Ding Darling National Wildlife Refuge, protecting a vital habitat of the Silver King and the birthplace of big game fishing.
Tarpon are incredibly important to the sport of big game fishing. They were pretty much the fish that big anglers historically cut their teeth on. They were probably the first fish that we considered a big game fish, big in size, stature, strong fighter, that anglers were able to catch with rod and reel. And after that, anglers were able to move on to larger offshore species such as tunas and billfishes. But it was really the tarpon that served as the foundation for that type of fishing. A lot of anglers will talk about their day fishing, not so much the number of fish that they caught, but how many they hooked or jumped, because it's just a given certainty that you're never really going to be able to catch 100% of the fish that you hook. And you know what? Most anglers are fine with that, because that bite, when that tarpon eats something, is one of the coolest things in all angling. Just incredible. That's the bite and the jump, you know, and even if you don't catch the fish, if you get those two things, you're in heaven.
Chromium Bright, the fearless aerialist with freight train strength, still reigns as the Silver King and the first fish of big game fishing.